From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now!
America will put our embassy in Jerusalem. That is what the American people want us to do. And it is the right thing to do. No vote in the United Nations will make any difference on that. But this vote will make a difference on how Americans look at the UN and on how we look at countries who disrespect us in the UN. And this vote will be remembered.
Defying threats from President Trump to cut off financial aid, 128 countries in the UN General Assembly vote in favor of a resolution condemning the U.S. decision to recognize Jerusalem as Israel's capital. We'll get response from Columbia University professor Rashid Khalidi, author of Brokers of Deceit, How the U.S. Has Undermined Peace in the Middle East. Then, not guilty. That was the verdict for all six defendants in the first J-20 trial of people arrested at Inauguration Day protests, including journalist Alexei Wood, who live-streamed the street detentions, including his own arrest.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I am currently being arrested. Yes, sir. Let me do it so it's facing me. I am currently being arrested. I am publishing. I'll follow any lawful order you give me.
In a broadcast exclusive, we'll speak with Alexei Wood, the independent photojournalist, and look at how 188 people still face trials over the next year. Then Catalonia votes for independence.
I want to congratulate the people of Catalonia because they have sent news to the world. Ladies and gentlemen, the Catalan Republic has defeated the monarchy of Article 155.
All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. At the United Nations, over 120 countries defied President Trump Thursday by voting in favor of a resolution calling for the United States to drop its recent recognition of Jerusalem as Israel's capital. The final vote, 128-9. 35 nations abstained, 21 countries did not cast a vote. The eight countries voting with the United States were Israel, Guatemala, Honduras, the Marshall Islands, Micronesia, Nauru, Palau, and Togo. Trump had threatened to cut off financial aid to countries that voted against the United States. On Thursday, Nikki Haley, the U.S. ambassador to the United Nations, reiterated Trump's threat after the vote.
America will put our embassy in Jerusalem. That is what the American people want us to do. And it is the right thing to do. No vote in the United Nations will make any difference on that. But this vote will make a difference on how Americans look at the UN and on how we look at countries who disrespect us in the UN. And this vote will be remembered.
In response to the UN vote, Palestinian politician Hanan Ashrawi praised the international community for standing up to the United States.
Well, I'm extremely encouraged that the vast majority of the states, of the members of the United Nations General Assembly, did not succumb to American threats and blackmail, and did not accept the Israeli insults being hurled at them. And they stood up for justice and for the rule of law and for what is right.
Former CIA Director John Brennan responded to the vote, posting a message on his new Twitter account saying, quote, "Trump admin threat to retaliate against nations that exercise sovereign right in UN to oppose U.S. position on Jerusalem is beyond outrageous, shows real Donald Trump expects blind loyalty and subservience from everyone, qualities usually found in narcissistic, vengeful autocrats," Brennan tweeted. We'll have more on the UN vote after headlines with Columbia professor Rashid Khalidi. In a major setback for Spain's government, Catalan separatist parties have won a slim majority in the Catalan parliament. Voters went to the polls Thursday in a snap election called for by Spanish Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy, who had sacked the previous separatist government. The deposed Catalan president, Carles Puigdemont, spoke on Thursday from Belgium, where he has been living in exile.
The Spanish state has been defeated. Rajoy and his allies have lost and have received a slap in the face from the Catalan people. They have lost the plebiscite through which they wanted to legalize their coup d'etat of the 155, and Catalonia has not helped them to make that possible. Rajoy has sunk in Catalonia. The prisoners must leave the prison right away, and the legitimate government must return right away to the Generalitat Palace, which is our home, where our citizens want us to be.
We'll have more on Catalonia later in the program. In news from the Middle East, the International Committee of the Red Cross is reporting the number of suspected cholera cases in Yemen has reached 1 million, making it the worst cholera epidemic on record. At least 2,200 people have already died from the outbreak, which began in April amidst the U.S.-backed Saudi-led bombing campaign, which began just over 1,000 days ago. According to the Red Cross, more than 80% of Yemenis now lack food, fuel, water and access to health care. A new investigation by the Associated Press has found as many as 11,000 civilians were killed in the U.S.-backed battle to recapture the Iraqi city of Mosul from the self-proclaimed Islamic State. The figure is far higher than official estimates. The U.S.-led coalition has claimed it's responsible for just 326 deaths. But the coalition never sent anyone to investigate civilian casualties. Chris Woods of the monitoring group Air Wars described the attack on Mosul as, quote, the biggest assault on a city in a couple of generations. Meanwhile, Vice President Mike Pence made an unannounced trip to Afghanistan, where the United States is fighting its longest war in history. He vowed the 16-year-old war will continue.
We vowed to win this war on our terms, on this soil. And together with our allies, we came here to Afghanistan to liberate its people and prevent the terrorists from ever threatening our homeland again. And we are staying in that fight, and we will see it through to the end.
A jury in Washington, D.C. has acquitted the first six people to stand trial after being arrested at protests during President Trump's inauguration. The defendants had faced up to 50 years in prison if they had been convicted. More than 180 others are still awaiting trial. We'll have more on the acquittals later in the broadcast. A federal judge has thrown out an ethics lawsuit against President Trump. The suit had alleged Trump had violated the Emoluments Clause of the U.S. Constitution, in part by accepting foreign government money via the new Trump International Hotel on Pennsylvania Avenue, just blocks from the White House. The group that filed the lawsuit, CREW, Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics in Washington, has vowed to appeal the ruling. In news from Capitol Hill, the Senate has approved a short-term spending measure to avert a government shutdown. The bill includes a temporary extension of the CHIP program, that's Children's Health Insurance Program, but it did not include the DREAM Act, which would grant legal status to recipients of the Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals Program, or DACA. On Thursday, eight DACA recipients and five allies were arrested inside the U.S. Capitol as they urged Democratic lawmakers to take action. In other news from Capitol Hill, Minnesota Democratic Senator Al Franken gave his final speech from the Senate floor Thursday. He announced earlier this month he would resign after at least seven women said he groped them or forcibly tried to kiss them without their consent. Franken accused President Trump and Republican lawmakers of misleading the American public on a host of issues, from tax reform to election integrity to climate change.
Before I came to the Senate, I was known as something of an obsessive on the subject of honesty in public discourse. But as I leave the Senate, I feel that I have to admit that it feels like we're losing the war for truth. And maybe it's already lost. And if that's the case, if that's what happens, then we have lost the ability to have the kinds of argument that help build consensus.
For the first time in over half a century, life expectancy in the United States has dropped for the second year in a row as the nation's opioid crisis intensifies. According to the National Center for Health Statistics, over 63,000 people died from drug overdoses in 2016. Drug overdoses are now the leading cause of death for Americans under the age of 55. In October, President Trump declared the opioid crisis a public health emergency, but he did not request any money to address the crisis. More than 3 months after Hurricane Maria battered Puerto Rico, about one-third of the island remains without power in what is by far the longest blackout in modern U.S. history. Officials say power won't be fully restored until the end of May. Many Puerto Ricans are now preparing to celebrate Christmas in the dark.
We still don't have power, even 3 months after the hurricane. We're living without light. We're living off a generator, and when we don't have money for gasoline, we're making do with batteries, with little battery-powered decorations for the tree. Because us Puerto Ricans are very family-oriented, and we like to celebrate everything.
In Memphis, Tennessee, statues of Confederate President Jefferson Davis and former Ku Klux Klan leader Nathan Bedford Forrest have been removed following a campaign led by a group called Take 'Em Down 901. On Wednesday night, the Memphis City Council voted to sell two city parks where the statues are located to a private nonprofit soon after the statues were removed. The sale was done in order to get around a state law barring the removal of memorials from public property. Memphis Mayor Jim Strickland said he'd wanted the statues removed before April, when the city will mark the 50th anniversary of the assassination of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., shot dead in the city April 4, 1968. In media news, New York Public Radio has fired two of the best-known hosts on WNYC, Leonard Lopate and Jonathan Schwartz. Both men had initially been suspended 2 weeks ago following allegations of sexual harassment. Meanwhile, Don Hazen, the head of the popular progressive news website Alternet, has been placed on indefinite leave after BuzzFeed revealed he had a long history of sexually harassing young female journalists who worked at Alternet. Five former Alternet writers and editors spoke on the record, describing Hazen inappropriately touching them, sending explicit emails, and in one case, showing a female staffer a photograph of his erect penis. Hazen told BuzzFeed he denies most of the allegations. One of the women who spoke to BuzzFeed now works as a producer for Democracy Now! And in sports news, the pioneering professional baseball player Mamie Johnson has died at the age of 82. She was the only woman known to have pitched in the Negro Leagues. Over three seasons with the Indianapolis Clowns in the early 1950s, she won 33 games while losing just eight. In 2009, Mamie Johnson spoke to the Visionary Project.
I used to dream about playing professional baseball. And then I used to think, hey, I know I can't do this because they won't even let the white boys play with the black boys, you know. And the black boys not even playing, so I know I'm not going to make it there. So, you know, that I kept playing and playing. I says, one day I'm going to play baseball.
Mamie Johnson died on Tuesday at the age of 82. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. At the United Nations, over 120 countries defied President Trump Thursday by voting in favor of a resolution calling for the United States to drop its recent recognition of Jerusalem as Israel's capital. The final vote, 128-9. 35 nations abstained, and 21 countries did not cast a vote. The eight countries voting with the United States were Israel, Guatemala, Honduras, Marshall Islands, Micronesia, Nauru, Palau, and Togo. Trump had threatened to cut off financial aid to countries that voted in favor. On Thursday, Nikki Haley, the U.S. ambassador to the United Nations, reiterated Trump's threat after the vote.
America will put our embassy in Jerusalem. That is what the American people want us to do. And it is the right thing to do. No vote in the United Nations will make any difference on that. But this vote will make a difference on how Americans look at the UN and on how we look at countries who disrespect us in the UN. And this vote will be remembered.
In response to the UN vote, Palestinian politician Hanan Ashrawi praised the international community for standing up to the United States.
Well, I'm extremely encouraged that the vast majority of the states of the members of the United Nations General Assembly did not succumb to American threats and blackmail and did not accept the Israeli insults being hurled at them. And they stood up for justice and for the rule of law and for what is right. And they voted on the basis of principle. 128 countries told the U.S. and Israel that what they're doing is wrong and unacceptable, and they voted for Jerusalem. They voted for the U.N. as an institution of integrity. They voted for the rule of law and for the requirements of a just peace.
Former CIA Director John Brennan responded to the vote, posting a message on his new Twitter account, tweeting, "Trump admin threat to retaliate against nations that exercise sovereign right in U.N. to oppose U.S. position on Jerusalem is beyond outrageous. Shows real Donald Trump expects blind loyalty and subservience from everyone, qualities usually found in narcissistic, vengeful autocrats," the former CIA director John Brennan tweeted. Control of Jerusalem is one of the most contested issues. Palestinians see East Jerusalem as the capital of their future state. Sustained protests continue in the Israeli-occupied Palestinian territories, despite a brutal Israeli crackdown. On Wednesday, dozens of Palestinian protesters were wounded after Israeli soldiers opened fire with live ammunition and tear gas against thousands of protesters. This is Hamas official Ismail Radwan.
We call on our Arabic and Muslim nations to surround the Israeli and American embassies in the Arab countries, then drive the American and Israeli ambassadors out of the Arab countries. We are continuing our way of resistance, using all kinds of resistance to break this decision.
Well, for more, we're joined by Rashid Khalidi, the Edward Said Professor of Arab Studies at Columbia University, author of a number of books, his most recent, Brokers of Deceit, How the U.S. Has Undermined Peace in the Middle East. Welcome back to Democracy Now!, Professor Khalidi. Your response to the U.N. General Assembly vote, 128-9.
Well, it's yet another instance of the Trump administration shooting themselves in the foot, making a big issue of a question where the entire world is, with the exception of 9 countries, are in agreement that there is international law on this issue. The Security Council decisions that the United States voted for are international law, and the United States is violating it. So it shouldn't be surprising that there was such a tiny number of states voting with the United States.
And what about the abstentions, the significance of, what was it, like 35? What
almost,
does that say?
It's almost the same vote as we had in 2012 for Palestine as a state. So there's basically no change. Trump's blackmail and bluster didn't seem to have had much effect.
And Nikki Haley and President Trump's threat to cut off aid, foreign aid, to countries who vote against the U.S., which would mean the majority of the world?
Precisely. I think most people said what anybody who looks at this carefully would say. Jerusalem is central to Palestine. Jerusalem is central to the whole issue. And if you prejudge something in favor of one party in violation of international law, you're just taking yourself out of the international consensus.
On Thursday, the U.S. ambassador to the U.N., Nikki Haley, defended Trump's decision to recognize Jerusalem as Israel's capital.
The decision was in accordance to U.S. law dating back to 1995, and its position has been repeatedly endorsed by the American people ever since. The decision does not prejudge any final status issues, including Jerusalem's boundaries. The decision does not preclude a two-state solution if the parties agree to that. The decision does nothing to harm peace efforts. Rather, the president's decision reflects the will of the American people.
Your response to the U.S. ambassador to the U.N., Haley?
There's not one single thing that Nikki Haley said that's true. 61% of people polled were against this in the United States, so it does not represent the will of the American people. Secondly, this not only damages the prospects of peace, this completely eliminates the United States as a potential broker. I wrote a book, Brokers of Deceit, in which I argue the United States has always been a dishonest broker. So, to my way of thinking, this is actually a silver lining in a cloud. The United States should be removed from its role. It should sit on the Israeli side of the table if it insists on being there. But it has no place setting the ground rules for a negotiation. Everything else that Nikki Haley said is also untrue. By accepting Jerusalem as Israel's capital, implicitly, the Trump administration is accepting Israel's definition of Jerusalem, which runs all the way down almost to the Jordan River. They're about to annex Ma'ali Adomim, Khan al-Ahmar, which means Israel now controls a swath, or will control, or will have annexed a swath, running all across the center of Palestine, cutting the northern part of the West Bank off from the southern part. That's the kind of thing that makes a Palestinian state completely impossible. So everything she said is false.
Talk about the protests on the ground. Israeli forces increasingly repressive in the occupied territories. Human rights groups deeply concerned about the number of arrests, the detaining of children, sometimes holding them without trial as the protests continue to rage over President Trump's decision to recognize Jerusalem as Israel's capital. On Tuesday, Israeli soldiers and border police raided the home of prominent 16-year-old Palestinian activist Ahad Tamimi, a day after video showing her confronting Israeli soldiers went viral. After Tamimi's arrest, the girl's mother, Narmam Tamimi, was detained at an Israeli police station as she inquired about the status of her daughter. And then you've got this other case. Witnesses say that 17-year-old Abdul Khalik Bernat was arrested earlier this week when he went out for pizza with friends. Bernat's father is Ayad Bernat, a leader of a nonviolent Palestinian resistance group whose work was highlighted in the Oscar-nominated documentary Five Broken Cameras. What about all of these situations?
Well, in the last case, the Israelis have been persecuting that family for a very long time because they're leading a nonviolent movement, which is exactly what the Israelis don't want to appear. They don't want it to be realized that they're holding an entire people down by force, and that when they rise up, even nonviolently, Israel cannot tolerate that. And the sad thing is there's nothing exceptional about these shootings or these detentions. This is the only way that an occupying force can hold millions of people down against their will for 50 years. The response to the Jerusalem decision is a normal response. People are outraged. And the Israelis respond by arresting children, holding them without a lawyer, without their parents, interrogating them, and in many cases putting them in administrative detention. The sad thing is that there's nothing new about this. This is the way a military occupation has to operate and will operate until somebody stops it.
And Ahad Tamimi?
Well, I mean, she's a very courageous girl. She did what she did. You saw on that piece of video, and typically she and her parents are probably going to suffer for her action. There's no recourse. Israeli military courts are kangaroo courts. 99-point-something% of people brought before them are convicted. So there is no justice in the Holy Land where the Palestinians are concerned.
The United Nations top human rights official recently condemned the killing of 29-year-old Palestinian Ibrahim Abu Thuraya, who was shot in the head by an Israeli sniper last Friday during a protest in the Gaza Strip. Abu Thuraya was a double amputee who lost both legs and a kidney in 2008 during an Israeli airstrike and used a wheelchair. This is Rupert Colville, spokesperson for the UN's Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights.
As far as we can see, there is nothing whatsoever to suggest that Ibrahim Abu Thuraya was posing an imminent threat of death or serious injury when he was killed. In the words of the High Commissioner, given his severe disability, which must have been clearly visible to those who shot him, his killing is incomprehensible, and it's a truly shocking and wanton act.
Your response to this UN spokesperson?
These are generally snipers using scopes. So this man was murdered by an Israeli soldier who saw him crawling without legs towards the border fence. He obviously could not have posed the slightest threat to the security of the state of Israel or to anybody except himself, because he defied the occupation.
So what is going to happen right now in the occupied territories? What does this mean for the Palestinian leadership?
I think it puts the Palestinian leadership and many Arab governments in a difficult position, which is a good thing. I think they should be forced at this stage by public opinion, as they were, as the vote shows many Arab governments were, to do the right thing. The right thing would be to say, we refuse the United States as a mediator, which the Arab League has actually said and the Islamic Conference has already said, and we insist on a completely new framework for negotiations. We insist on a fair two-state solution, not based on the cherry-picked resolutions that the United States and Israel decide should be the basis. I mean, this is actually an opportunity, if it will only be taken, by governments that unfortunately are all too frequently willing to listen to what the United States tells them in the bullying, threatening tone.
How different is what Trump did from what President Obama did. I didn't say said. His rhetoric is very different. But right. even when he made this announcement and then with a flourish showed this document he was signing to right. the cameras in front of him at the White House, people didn't realize at the time he was signing the very waiver that Trump and that Obama and Clinton had signed before, a waiver right. that said they wouldn't build right. the embassy in Jerusalem for at least another 6 months.
You're absolutely right. The difference is the action. The difference is the embassy is not going to be moved for a while. But declaring that the United States supports the Israeli position on Jerusalem is of enormous material importance. It means that the United States has taken a stand on the most important issue. Jerusalem relates to sovereignty. Jerusalem relates to settlements. Jerusalem relates, obviously, to the holy places. And Jerusalem relates to borders. Even if you say this doesn't prejudge borders, the Israelis have a definition of Jerusalem. You've just recognized Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. The Israelis are going to take this and run with it. So it is of enormous importance. Other presidents have said, in fact, going back to Clinton, presidents have said, we want to move the embassy or we will move the embassy. But they haven't done it, and they haven't accepted the Israeli position as President Trump has just done.
And no country has their embassy, is that right, in
that
Jerusalem?
Is correct.
They all
that
have them in
correct.
Tel Aviv.
Even those who said, we accept West Jerusalem as Israel's capital have said, but we won't move until a negotiation resolves this issue.
What about Saudi Arabia? Saudi Arabia was critical, mm-hmm. And immediately Trump attacked, interestingly, what seems to be one of his closest allies, Saudi Arabia, for saying this. But behind the scenes, what is Saudi Arabia saying, do you believe?
I mean, what we hear—I mean, I was recently in the region twice, and what I gather is that Jared Kushner and the Crown Prince are cooking up a plan for what they call a Palestinian state, which would not include Jerusalem, which would not be sovereign, which would not be contiguous, and which would have to negotiate for its borders. In other words, you declare the state and you go into another interim period. We've been in an interim period since 1993, 25 almost years. Actually, 25 years next year. And this is what this administration and apparently the Saudis are cooking up. It is a travesty. I mean, it would be an insult to apartheid South Africa to call what they're offering a Bantustan.
Apparently, President Trump, in just speaking to the British Prime Minister, Theresa May, singled out Mohammed bin Salman around the Saudi war in Yemen, mm-hmm. the U.S.-backed Saudi war. Mm-hmm. He seems to be ruffled by what Saudi Arabia said about Israel. But as you pointed out, Jared Kushner is extremely close to Salman and mm-hmm. has been there a number of times. Trump made his first trip there.
Right. He's apparently made several unannounced trips, Kushner has, to Saudi Arabia. I think the president's peak over Yemen is new. But the United States actually took a position on the Yemeni war—sorry—on the Saudi war on Yemen a while before this Jerusalem decision. I find that a little bit strange, frankly. This is a war that could only be prosecuted with American support. It's a war that for 2 years has had American support. And
Trump announced he was giving more weapons to them for that war.
Precisely. And now he is—now he's criticizing this. It could be partly because of Jerusalem, but in fact, I think it goes back before that. They may be embarrassed by the fact they've helped to create the largest humanitarian disaster in the modern world. Perhaps—I doubt that they're capable of shame, but perhaps they're slightly embarrassed by this.
Talk about what you see as a solution for Palestine.
Well, it has to be based on complete equality of rights. In other words, if Israel or Israelis get certain rights, Palestinians have to have the same rights. It has to be based on a principle of justice. It cannot be based on a cherry-picked set of resolutions that give Israel pretty much everything it wants, or a framework for negotiation where everything is tipped in Israel's favor. That means you have to have a framework and an outside mediator that's completely different from everything that we've dealt with since Camp David back in the 70s up through Oslo in the 90s.
Who do you think that mediator can be?
Anybody but the United States would be my personal pick. Literally any country except the eight small, tiny countries that voted with the United States. So take your pick of the other 188, whatever, countries.
The piece you wrote in The Guardian is headlined, Trump's Error on Jerusalem is a Disaster for the Arab World and the U.S., too.
Mm-hmm. Well, I wrote a later piece in which I said there are silver linings to those clouds. It is a disaster because it's a slap in the face of the Arabs. It's an indication of exactly how divided and weak the Arab world is. The United States can take a position in support of the Israeli position on the most important question at issue in the entire conflict since the 40s. I mean, Jerusalem was singled out in the 1947 partition resolution for special treatment, and it's been treated as special. And the Trump administration has just said, we don't care about what any of you think, international law, Arabs, we're going to go ahead and do what we think is right. But they should and could use this as an opportunity and say, okay, fine, you've disqualified yourself as a broker, a mediator, an intermediary. Very good, we'll find another one. The other four permanent members of the Security Council, China, EU, Brazil, it almost doesn't matter, India, a collection of large countries that could presumably be immune to the browbeating and pressure and blackmail that the United States customarily exercises, usually behind the scenes. This is unusual in that they've gone out publicly with it.
Do you think the two-state solution is dead?
I think Israel has systematically murdered it over 50 years. I mean, everything that they have done in terms of colonization, occupation, and seizure of land pretty much makes a two-state solution impossible. Tony Judt once said, what one politician has done, another politician can undo. I would like to see the American president and the Israeli prime minister, who is going to uproot 600,000 Israeli citizens from the territories they've systematically colonized for 50 years. If it could be done, maybe you could have a two-state solution, but I don't think it can be done. I think we're stuck with the one-state solution that Israel has created. The only question is, will this be an apartheid or a completely discriminatory one-state solution, which is what we have now, or will it be one in which both peoples have national rights and everybody has equal rights? You don't have special rights because you have this ethnicity or this religion.
Talk about what's happening on the ground in Gaza right now.
You have what's happening in Yemen and what's happening in Syria dwarfs it in a certain sense. But this is a humanitarian crisis that's actually been going on for more than a decade. You have groundwater that's polluted with sewage, which can't be pumped because there's no electricity, which is where there's salinity increasing because seawater seeps in. You have these cuts in electricity. You have people unable to rebuild, in many cases, since 2014, the last Israeli assault on Gaza. You have people living in the largest open-air prison on Earth. And it has been going on for the better part of a decade. So, again, Syria, Yemen certainly are much more grave crises today in terms of the humanitarian situation. But Gaza is a running sore, a festering sore, and it should be it's something that is a shame to the international community, that it allows Israel and Egypt and the Palestinian Authority and Hamas to, in effect, torture the people of Gaza in this way.
Rashid Khalidi, we want to thank you for being with us. Edward Said, professor of Arab Studies at Columbia University, the author of several books, his most recent, Brokers of Deceit, How the U.S. Has Undermined Peace in the Middle East. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, not guilty on all counts. That's the verdict in the first J-20 trial, the trial of the protesters of Donald Trump's inauguration. Stay with us.
Zulum. كل بيعاني منه. الأمريكان تظلم العرب الصهاينة يظلم العرب تعرف إيش عربي إذا بتظلم غيرك غيرنا بظلمنا أي هاي الكلمات لكل إمياتنا وأخواتنا اللي تايهات بين عادات جاهلة تقاليد تافهة الكل شافها بس مين دافع الكل يحس بس أنا واحد يطلع حس يعني هاي إلك وين ما تكوني مسجونة مهضومة من أحلامك محرومة ارفعي راسك لفوق يا أختي ارفعي راسك لفوق بكاء بلا صوت من ماسحة الدموع قد معيونها تفتح مداها سياج الممنوع قلتها ممنوع لي ممنوع لها مسموح لي ممنوع لها والمسموح لها فيش كلمة هيك بقاموسها توقفنا عاجرين اللي تدوس حقوقها يوم ورا يوم تعيد نفس اليوم الأولى بالقوم والأخيرة بالنوم هذا مني إلك يا امرأة يا أم البيت مني أنا الرجل اللي بس بنيلك فيه حيط لسجن الحريم الحيطان وما تتيسر للرواية التاريخية ما تتحضر
Freedom for My Sisters by the Palestinian hip-hop group Dom. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. In a blow to the Trump administration's efforts to silence dissent, the first trial of people arrested at Inauguration Day disrupt J-20 protests ended Thursday with all the defendants defendants found not guilty on all charges. Six people face multiple felonies and 50 years in prison for just being in the area where anti-fascist and anti-capitalist protesters were marching. During the protests, police blockaded more than 200 people into a corner in a process known as kettling and carried out mass arrests of everyone nearby. Those arrested included protesters, medics, legal observers, and some journalists. Many were trapped in the kettle for as long as 9 hours after police had doused them with pepper spray. They were denied food, water, and access to bathrooms. This first case was closely watched as a bellwether for free speech because one of the six people on trial was Alexei Wood, an independent photojournalist from San Antonio, Texas, whose work focuses on resistance movements. He came to document protests during the inauguration on January 20th and live streamed the street detentions by police and even his own arrest. Prosecutors played his entire 42-minute video stream in court, noting he could be heard cheering at some points when some of the protesters painted graffiti or broke windows. Earlier this month, the judge in the case cited the video when she dismissed the inciting a riot felony charge, saying cheering is not enough evidence to prove incitement. Judge Lynn Leibovitz of the D.C. Superior Court said, quote, "Personal enthusiasm for the destruction is qualitatively different from urging others to destroy," she said. After the not guilty on all counts verdict came down on Thursday, supporters gathered outside the courthouse to meet the defendants and held a banner that read, "Love for all who resist." This is Alexei Wood's attorney, Brett Cohen, speaking after the verdict.
Journalism issue was greater for Mr. Wood, and freedom of speech was kind of there as well, because I spoke about it a little bit in closing that if you just turned off the volume, you don't hear, you know, you wouldn't think that Mr. Wood was doing anything wrong, so a lot of it was about what he was saying. He didn't come with an intent to be with the protesters for protesting. He was just there to cover whatever he thought would be a juicy story that he could sell to others.
All this comes as 188 people still face trials over the next year after being arrested during that Inauguration Day protests against Trump, including another Texas native, journalist Aaron Cantu. Well, for more, we're joined in Washington by Alexei Wood, the independent photojournalist who was just found not guilty, along with his five co-defendants in the J-20 case. And in Houston, we're joined by Jude Ortiz, a member of the organizing crew of Defend J-20 and the Mass Defense Committee chair for National Lawyers Guild. He's been in the court throughout this first J-20 trial. We welcome you both to Democracy Now. Well, Alexei Wood, let's begin with you. This is the first time you are speaking out during this trial. It just ended. What is your response? What was it like to hear the 42 not guilties yesterday?
I was in utter tears. I just couldn't handle myself emotionally. I was just so happy for everybody that everybody got full acquittals on every single one of these ridiculous charges.
And how do you feel? Your own vindication?
I mean, I could woohoo now, but it's kind of a—it would be a shtick at this point. I feel utterly stoked, you know? I feel calm. I feel grounded. I feel just as innocent now as I did when they were arresting me. And there's 188 more defendants to go, so let's get them.
This is a clip of you, Alexei Wood, during your live stream coverage of the protests during a Trump's inauguration.
So, howdy, folks. We got ourselves, let me see how many, three blocks of black block.
And this is a video of our guest, Alexei Wood, filming his own arrest during his live stream coverage of the protest against Trump's inauguration.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I am currently being arrested. Yes, sir. Let me do it so it's facing me. Yeah. I am currently being arrested. I am publishing. I'll follow any lawful order you give me.
So, Alexei Wood, they played the entire video of your live stream in the trial. Talk about that day you were arrested and what it felt like to live stream your own arrest and what was happening there.
Sure. I mean, on January 20th, there was a massive show of resistance to the inauguration of Trump. I mean, it was everywhere. The city was alive and buzzing. And I found the anti-capitalist, anti-fascist march and protest. And I was just like, I'm going to go check that out. And, you know, I started live streaming and I just spoke freely and, you know, I was stoked, you know. I know the prosecution wants to me feel all horrific about broken windows or whatever, but like it was so fun, and you know, like it was, you know, resistance with teeth, and I think this country could really use that.
What did you feel when Judge Leibovitz said that your own personal cheering captured on the live stream was not an incitement to riot? You were just expressing your own feelings.
Woo! Yeah, for sure. That was a close one. I mean, this is narrative warfare. You know, the government and prosecution has their narrative. You know, resistance movement have their narratives. And, you know, there's a lot of things going on here. So to have something so genuine that I just put myself out there, I didn't know it was going to be this big, huge deal, and for somebody, i.e. the government, to be like, you are an evil criminal person, like, it was just BS. But, you know, I don't know, you just, things get projected on you, and you just have to know your own boundaries.
Alexei, if you could talk about how you felt your video was used.
Thank you. You know, I'm stoked that people can watch it from beginning to end. It became this big old First Amendment issue, press freedom issue. It's every single thing I did and said or didn't do or didn't say is there. That part I love. The fact that it's being used against other co-defendants, I hate that. I hate that so much. You know, it's a live stream. It's out there. But, I mean, this was a targeted mass arrest dragnet where journalists and legal observers, I mean, everybody, and they're just trying to pin this on somebody. And that is not okay. That is absolutely not okay.
How did they get your video, Alexei?
Well, I put it out there. You know, the original timestamp is on Facebook. I put it on YouTube. I put it on Vimeo. I promoted it. I wanted people to know about that day, about what was happening.
I mean, at the time, Alexei, you were even saying things like, "Oh wow, I've got only like 2 viewers."
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, exactly. I don't care. I don't care who my audience is. I'm just doing my thing, and it could be 1,000. It could be 2. Like, I knew it was a historical moment, and specifically the anti-capitalist, anti-fascist march and demonstration. It was just like, I mean, people are pissed off.
Well, I wanted to ask you about the prosecutor Qureshi's comments when he said in his closing arguments that a street medic was guilty by being present and asked, "What do you need a medic with gauze for? She was aiding and abetting the riot. That was her role." And yet, your video that they wanted to use against you and others showed police attacking protesters, which showed the need for medics.
Yeah, I mean, the whole thing was ridiculous. Even reasonable doubt was don't put too much weight on it, according to the prosecution. It's like, what? Yeah, a medic with gauze. I mean, just grasping at their narrative of the criminal. This was about protest. This was about free speech. This was freedom of the press. I don't care if I cussed. You know, like I'm trying not to do it here. I understand, but I don't care. And that day was so wicked awesome.
In her opening statement in this first J-20 trial, where you were on trial, Assistant U.S. Attorney Jennifer Kirchhoff told the jury on November 20th, quote, "We don't believe the evidence is going to show that any of these six individuals personally took that crowbar or that hammer and hit the limo or personally bashed those windows of that Starbucks in. You don't personally have to be the one that breaks the window to be guilty of rioting." That was Assistant U.S. Attorney Jennifer Kirchhoff. Now I want to turn to one of the jurors from this first J-20 trial describing their decision-making process after they returned acquittals on all charges. The juror, identified as Steve, told the media collective Unicorn Riot on Wednesday, quote, "It was not a close call. The prosecution admitted the morning of day one that they would present no evidence that any of the defendants committed any acts of violence or any vandalism. From that point, before the defense ever uttered a sound, it was clear to me that ultimately we would find everyone not guilty. And while there was a great deal of careful discussion among the jurors, it ultimately, at no point, did it seem even possible that a guilty verdict would come down. This was not close." Again, those are the words of a person named Steve, a juror named Steve. Alexei Wood, your response.
Yes, yeah, Steve. Yeah, I think, I mean, you have to understand that. I mean, I had indicted twice, like superseding indictments, so three times, conspiracy, aiding and abetting theory for property destruction. I mean, it was just like it was like 5 weeks of mind-boggling, like, legal gymnastics, or, like, contortion even. And full acquittals on all of us, you know? Like, so I praise the jury for sitting there for 5 weeks.
Alexei, you know, will your video be used in the next trials? I mean, there are trials now for the whole year that are coming up. You talk about the video being used against protesters, but in a sense, didn't the video also vindicate people, showing the police beating on protesters?
I mean, anybody who was filming that day got police beating up protesters and pepper spray. I mean, like, it was you know, I am, you know, my little live stream that the prosecution is using, you know, they made a big deal about it. They hyped it up. But there is so much video out there that is all being used as this in this like the surveillance state, like wicked, wicked, interesting way. But, you know, like it was a protest, you know, you don't like the message. Tough.
Alexei,
and here we are.
Before we go, do you plan to continue to document resistance movements?
Oh, hell yeah.
And I want to bring in Jude Ortiz as we wrap up. Jude, what does this 42 non-guilty verdicts, 42 not guilties in the first trial, everyone completely acquitted, what does this mean for the more than 180 people who are going on trial in the next year?
Well, the full acquittals are a resounding victory for resistance movements. For the remaining defendants, there's still like a lot of fighting to do, a long way to go. The next trial block has an uncertain date at this point. Next status here is in January. And then there are trials set from March all the way through October. And so it's still a lot of fighting to do, a lot of legal battles and maneuvering. But everyone is feeling very strong and very emboldened, like, by this clear victory. And we're looking forward to getting more acquittals in the coming year. And also, people all around the country, around the world, will continue to support the defendants as they fight their charges.
Each case now has a different judge. And finally, what did the was the significance of the points of unity that 130 of the defendants agreed upon? And explain that.
Yeah, so the points of unity were formed very early on after people were charged. And that was basically a statement of solidarity and unity together in fighting back against the state repression. So the vast majority of the defendants signed onto that and agreed basically to work collectively and cooperatively in order to figure out a way of handling their cases that would not aid in the state repression and would not allow the government to pit each other or each defendant against the other. So this was a really historic development, a historic statement in the case. There's been a lot of historic events that have come up with this case, including this historic victory by the full acquittals. And so as we move forward into the remaining trials, and as defendants continue to fight back and push back, I think we're going to see a lot more historical developments and hopefully a lot more historic losses for the state in trying to repress radical left social movements.
Jude Ortiz, want to thank you for being with us, member of the organizing crew of Defend J20. And I want to thank Alexei Wood, independent photojournalist found not guilty in the first J20 trial. A very stoked independent journalist. 42 not guilties handed down yesterday. All defendants were found not guilty. At the beginning of this trial, a number of them faced 75 years in jail. This is Democracy Now! When we come back, the significance of the independence vote in Catalonia. Stay with us. I give you power over me. I give you power. Now gotta be free. I give you power. But now I say, I give you power. I can take it away. I can take it away. I Give You Power by Arcade Fire featuring Mavis Staples. This is Democracy Now! I'm Amy Goodman. In a major setback for the government of Spain, Catalan separatist parties have won a slim majority in the Catalan parliament. Voters went to the polls Thursday in a snap election called for by the Spanish Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy, who had sacked the previous separatist government. The deposed Catalan president, Carles Puigdemont, spoke Thursday from Belgium, where he's been living in exile, along with other members of the Catalan government, those who haven't been jailed.
The Spanish state has been defeated. Rajoy and his allies have lost and have received a slap in the face from the Catalan people. They have lost the plebiscite, through which they wanted to legalize their coup d'etat of the 155, and Catalonia has not helped them to make that possible. Rajoy has sunk in Catalonia. The prisoners must leave the prison right away, and the legitimate government must return right away to the Generalitat Palace, which is our home, where our citizens want us to be.
Thursday's vote comes after Catalonia's regional parliament voted in October for independence by a margin of 70 to 10. The Spanish Senate in Madrid swiftly responded by granting Spanish Prime Minister Mariano Rajoy unprecedented powers to impose direct rule on Catalonia under Article 155 of the Constitution, which had never been used before in modern Spain's democratic history. The move stripped the northeastern region of its autonomy in efforts to crush Catalonia's growing independence movement. Rajoy then called for new elections, counting on Catalan voters to support pro-unity parties. Now, Puigdemont has asked Rajoy for a meeting in Brussels or any place of his choice to hold talks, quote, with no pre-existing conditions about the future of Catalonia. For more, we go to Cleveland, Ohio. We're joined by Sebastian Faber, who is professor of Hispanic Studies at Oberlin College and author of the new book, Memory Battles of the Spanish Civil War, History, Fiction, Photography. Professor Faber, welcome back to Democracy Now! Explain the significance of this vote.
Well, you have to understand these elections took place under very unusual circumstances. Like you just said, they were called by the government in Madrid after it had revoked Catalan autonomy. And they happened against the backdrop of increased judicial persecution of the leaders of the independence movement. It's really remarkable that despite the fact that the leaders of both the two largest pro-independence parties were either in exile or in prison, that despite that, the pro-independence parties continued to win a majority of seats in the Catalan parliament. The other significant data point here is that the party of Prime Minister Rajoy, the Partido Popular, lost two-thirds of its support in Catalonia. It already had very little support. It's now reduced to a mere 3 seats in parliament, a little over 4% of the vote. So you could say that currently still, under Article 155 of the Constitution, the party that's governing in Catalonia, which is Rajoy's Partido Popular, is a party that currently enjoys a little over 4% of electoral support.
So explain what's happening, Professor Faber, for people who are not paying attention to this at all. Talk about the leadership, the governing leadership of Catalonia in jail.
Well, so the, in the beginning of September, the Catalan Parliament put in process in motion a process to move toward a declaration of independence. On October 1st, there was a referendum, which was held despite the fact that the Spanish state did what it could to stop it. And in that referendum, a majority of people voted for independence. And then the Catalan Parliament went ahead and finally came to something of a declaration of independence at the end of October. Because all this is considered to be a violation of the Spanish Constitution, at the same time, a judicial process was put in place that basically ended up persecuting everybody who had worked towards independence, including the leadership of these pro-independence parties. So the Junqueras, the leader of the Esquerra Republicana Party, the left Republican Catalan Party, has been in prison since then. While the leader of the what used to be really the largest conservative party in Catalonia decided to not run any risk and leave the country, and he's been in Brussels in exile since then. So it's really important to understand that despite the fact that despite what happened yesterday, where the pro-independence parties continued to hold on to a majority of seats, this judicial process is continuing. In fact, this very morning, so the morning after the elections, the Spanish Supreme Court announced that it was further indicting a bunch of other leaders of the pro-independence movement, of all the different pro-independence parties, as well as the civil society movement that has been supporting independence. And you could describe this as a kind of McCarthyism, where what is in principle a legitimate political position, which is the idea that Catalonia is better off on its own as an independent republic, has become criminalized. And in the same way that in the 1950s, communism was a reason to persecute political ideas, the same is happening now in Spain, where the judicial branch of the Spanish state is applying pressure and sort of setting boundaries to what is sayable and thinkable politically.
And the significance of Puigdemont saying he wants to meet with Rajoy, he'll meet with him anywhere outside of Spain with no precondition?
Rajoy has said already this morning in the press conference that he is not going to talk with Puigdemont anywhere. Rajoy, in his typical stubborn denial fashion, has said he's not going to do that. One could wonder how long this this attitude of Rajoy, this kind of denialism of Rajoy, can withstand reality, the political reality of the fact that at least about half of people in Catalonia do not see the Spanish state as their state and want to leave. It's really unclear whether Rajoy can keep this up, but he's going to for sure try. Currently, the Catalan self-government, it continues to be revoked. Rajoy said this morning he will the self-government will be reinstituted as soon as a new government has been formed. And now the question is whether the three pro-independence parties will be able to actually form a government. They do have a majority of seats, but there's three of them, and they don't see eye to eye on everything. So it's still up for question whether this government can be formed. And it's up to question how the government will look, because of the 70 pro-independence deputies that were elected yesterday, 8 are either in exile or in prison currently.
I want to thank you very much, Sebastian Faber, for joining us, professor of Hispanic Studies at Oberlin College, author of the new book, Memory Battles of the Spanish Civil War: History, Fiction, and Photography. Tune in Monday for our holiday special when we speak with Noam Chomsky for the hour. We'll talk about climate change, nuclear weapons, North Korea, Iran, and the Republican Party. He says the Republican Party in the United States today is the most dangerous organization on earth. This is Democracy Now. I am Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us.